Hello, this is Ezekiel Dasho, and I'm going to draw this chimpanzee. I'm going to start with the top, sort of the crest or the top area of his skull, and maybe move it just a little bit this way. So I'll start here, and this arc here is going to give me a place to measure everything else from. So just quickly building the form and rough sketching it in. We've got this ear and got some hair here. The top of the ear, sort of if you imagine this arch here, creates this space or this area where his eyebrows or her eyebrows reside. And so just we'll gently see his sideburns or her sideburns drop down. And kind of has like a middle cut. The hair parts in the middle a little bit there. So moving along, we'll just following this arch here, this arc, we'll put in this ear. And the top of this ear is a little bit higher than the ear on the left of the picture. So just keeping that in mind, we'll do the general shape. It kind of arches up, then takes a slight turn, and then another turn, and then another turn, and the bottom is sort of on the same level as a little bit along the arc of as the other ear. And then just quickly getting the some of the shading in there. So let's add the sideburns here. And now let's just kind of flesh out the shape of the face a little bit more and the position of the eyes. So using these like imaginary arcs between like around the head, if you're imagining the head as kind of a cylinder or a sphere, the eyes sort of come like the corner of the eye starts sort of around the middle of the ear. And they're kind of almond shaped, and they're not very big. And there's this rather pronounced ridge, this brow or a nose ridge between them. And we can go ahead and use these points as ways to sort of move into the rest of the face and mouth area here. And rather than just like draw a big oval or something like that, we'll just like lightly sketch in kind of what we see. And part of it is obscured by the little paper that he's holding, which I do want to draw because I think it's kind of cool that he's holding that. And this is a picture from the Creative Commons, and it said it was taken in the Los Angeles Zoo, so kind of looks like, hey, why am I in captivity? Plus, I want some new reading material. Okay, so let's see. We got a little bit of nose here, and these kind of two L-shaped indentations for the nostrils, and then a little bit of shading there, and more shading here. He's kind of sort of a smile, and I want to make sure that I get the lips in the right vertical position. I know, horizontally where they're going to be, but I need to get them accurate to the vertical so that the drawing retains its look. And then so it's kind of got those like little white little stubble here, and then okay, so that kind of blocks in the head, and we can detail it a little more as we go. And next we'll go over to his back area and just kind of look at this space here between the ear and the back, and that kind of gives you a idea of the angle that you need to angle the back away. And you know, one of the reasons I chose this picture is because the chimpanzee is covered with fur, so it kind of lends itself well to shading and pencil drawing, especially for people who are newer, you know, because it gives you some latitude to move around without having to worry about, you know, committing to a single line and like, you know, making a mistake and not being able to correct it or something. So his arm bends all the way down there, his elbow, and goes up the inside of his elbow. And I've got this dark triangle, which where the shade is cast from the paper and everything. Okay, so this paper will kind of just outline it in to kind of have a rough idea of where that goes later. And his arm is entirely obscured by that one point. So his arm is like almost up to his chin though. So his wrist gets really close to his chin there. And then his hand comes out. Okay, so the paper, kind of just to keep it moving along and giving us that sense of reference, comes around here, and then his hand with the fingers that are much bigger than they would be on a human form of around the same size. So the hand kind of does this straight line thing here, and the fingers are sort of on display a little bit. And then the other hand is wrapped around, and just getting that angle there of that first finger will help you. And the ball shape on the knuckle will help you get these shapes established. The next finger is about as thick as that one, and maybe even a little thicker. And let's see, actually, I can see the other two, but they start to angle away, so just barely visible to the camera. And then he's kind of clenching this paper thing. Okay, so his knee comes out. It's above his elbow, and you can kind of see this arc, you know, starts to crumple up the paper, and his knee, sort of the top of his knee is about around where his wrist is. And that can give you a good place to triangulate that in there. And basically this shape here is, you know, kind of an oval here, and then it's a little furry, and there are some curves. His feet do these nice, interesting looking angles and curves. So let's see. Just gonna quickly kind of rough these in and not worry about the detail too much. Curves away, or the rather toward us as the heel's coming toward us. And we'll add more later. And then finishing up here, his round where this knuckle is, his other leg starts to extend. And then the knee happens a little bit above his toe and starts to angle down this way. So we've got this line here and this line here. And you see a little bit of his thigh. And then so he's sitting on this rock. We'll draw a little bit of the rock surface in. And that just kind of gives us a spot to use as a reference then. We don't want to worry about drawing too much of this other foot, just what we see in the picture. And it's like almost exactly like a hand. If someone came up to me and told me there's an animal with hands for feet, I would think that's really creepy and weird. Sounds like a Dark Souls monster. But no, it's real. And weirdly, they're kind of cute. Okay. So we can put more work into those feet and hands and all that stuff as we go here. Maybe just quickly just shade some of this out. So we've got this light spot. We may as well block that out now so that we kind of avoid putting too much shading on it. And then right next to it's this rather dark area that extends almost all the way up to his hand, and it's still dark up toward his hand on the paper here, but it's not nearly as dark as it is in this spot here where his black fur is kind of in the shadow a little bit. And we get this crinkly paper, which is basically just a series of, shadows, and definitely more complex as you dig into it, but don't be daunted by it. It's just a matter of, drawing the shadows where you see shadows and not really trying to draw it line by line. So now it's just adding some texture and some fur and some additional shading. For some of these areas, I know, they're going to be pretty dark, so I'm not afraid to just get in there and push in a little harder because they are going to be darker. And they've already been blocked in lightly, so the guides are there. And so this area right here, get that nice and dark, and then it'll be able to contrast against his cheek and face as well as against the paper thing that he's holding. So on his head, you can see there's like this lighter area close to his ear, then with the curvature of his head and his hair, gets darker. And there's a little shininess going on up there too. So, you know, leaving some of that area lighter will help to preserve that shiny look in the drawing. And this area is not nearly as shiny as the one up top. But you definitely, I would advise against trying to draw, you know, every single hair, but rather just looking for the shadows. And in some places, you know, you're doing a motion to kind of communicate the feel of the hair, but not really trying to draw every hair as much as you're trying to draw the sections of it in terms of like lighting. So like this, what I'm, just to demonstrate, like this section here that I'm drawing around is all basically the same shade of black. So I'm just getting that sort of similar, like same shade on mine and same shape too. So rather than trying to draw each hair, I just have this section here that's correct. And then it, once it all starts to get put together, it'll really look more like hair than if we just took a pencil and drew hair all over it, line by line. So there's this shadow on his ear. And go in and darken this up even a little more. It's pretty light up near the top of his ear. And then this shadow here is kind of an angle shape, triangle shape shadow. And then he's got this deeper shadow here. This flux capacitor looking shadow. Shade those places in first and then go over the whole area again. And add some of these darker spots here. Now for like these areas on the back here, I am gonna just like do these wispy lines a little bit because that's what I'm kind of seeing in the picture. And so like there are places where you do want to draw, you know, like a single hair here or there or a clump of them to keep your picture looking like what you see. So here there's almost like a little patch of hair that covers that shoulder muscle and then another one that comes down over his tricep a little bit. And another one that kind of is curved more along like the bicep and the accent this line on his face a little bit, and let's add some depth to the eyes here. They're looking kind of lifeless, so I'm just gonna go, you know, following the picture and what I see, just go around the top because there's quite a dark line with the eyelashes, and then I'm seeing his iris kind of looking like that. And maybe a pupil like that, and then kind of just shading in the rest. And down here, that's where his nose starts. So then we'll just swoop in a little bit there. Swoop in up there. And let's see, those are nice places to use to triangulate where your, you know, the points of the eyes are and the. So with the pupil, I'm not really drawing like a full circle. I'm just kind of drawing like a little C symbol so that I can leave some light in the eye. And so that it's not so dark. A little bit of reflectivity there to make it look like it's, you know, alive. And I see a little bit more light in the picture in like the bottom of his left eye, but if the light's right in the bottom of his eyes, it's like similar to the picture. I mean, it's going to look nice and accurate if you can get it right, but it's also you know, it's not super critical unless you plan on showing your picture right beside the photograph that you've drawn. Just I think the main thing is getting, you know, some darkness in there and getting, leaving, you know, don't leave the whites of the eyes white, but do go ahead and leave a little light in the iris or in the pupil to sort of, it'll just make it look more alive. And so we've got this sort of highlighting around the tops of the eyebrows. And then a little bit of like furrowing in the brow, kind of. This nose ridge is quite dark, so go ahead and darken that up. And then he's got some like wrinkles under his eyes too. And so these little like details and accents and stuff, just, you know, don't worry about being exactly photorealistic, but do try to do it as best you can, and it'll come through in your picture. And, you know, if you've blocked out your picture well, and, you know, you're just being true to where you see the values and in one sense, you want to be, you know, I want to be as true to life as I can be, but in another sense, I'm not going to like bust out a ruler and a magnifying glass and a, you know, measuring tape and all this stuff to make everything so extremely accurate. Because I mean, this is more about drawing like straight up for what you see from life or from a photograph. Or, you know, you could do this in any setting. You could be out in the field or whatever and see something, and if it's holding still, you could draw it. So this is to kind of practice those skills. So now this crumply paper, I don't know how crumply my paper looks. I'm not gonna spend tons of time on it, just enough to make it clear that he's holding something and not too concerned about, you know, is it a blanket, is it some paper, whatever. It's something. And it looks kind of crumpled, you know, and I'm just going with what I see here, but it's not gonna spend tons of time on that. That is up to the artist himself. If you want to spend a good amount of time on that, it'll look cool. Like if you did this really big, you know, if I was going to do this on a gigantic piece of paper or something like that, I might go ahead and get all those details in there. And so here, like here, see, there's this sort of bald patch around his elbow a little bit. And rather than drawing each hair, I'm kind of like looking for these like almost like black M shapes, like black V shapes, and then just seeing which way they flow. And then for like the edge of the elbow where the hair is lighter and the light's shining through it a little bit, then I think the like wispy sort of like gentle long lines can kind of help with that. So we're almost finished up here. Ooh, better definitely gotta give this monkey a back. Might as well give him a rock to sit on too. It's your call, like how much detail you want to get into on the rock, but I'm gonna keep that minimal just to show that there's, there is indeed something there. I do want to go into this hand a little bit, and as particularly with the creases of his, like I guess it would be his index finger and the rest. And I don't want to make it look cartoony at all. I just want to stick to what I see in the picture. But you can see, on the photo, his the creases are very well shadowed there as they get closer to his fingers, and then they kind of some light gets in a little more. But his hand is also making a it's very dark there. So then above his index finger too, pretty dark shadow, not, straight up black, but pretty close. And here on this finger you can see a little fingernail, and that and then the bottom of his finger too is pretty dark. So the fingernail gets defined, like the bottom of the fingernail just gets defined by the shadow beneath it. The top, actually, you can see the you can see it. And so the let's see how far does the fur on this foot go? It goes about to there. And I think that the reason I want to get this detail in is, well, I know it's because, it is a defining feature, and it's also just really fun, and there are a couple reasons. And mainly that this defining feature aspect, but the gosh, I could go on and on about why I wanted to get that in there. There's not a lot going on in the picture over on this side of it, so it gives the picture something to kind of anchor it on this side. It also just kind of shows, that like what the foot looks like. And his other hands are kind of hidden in those areas. Like there are different pieces of each hand or foot that are visible. But in this area, you actually get to see like the, I don't know, the front of the fingers a little bit, the tips. And it's definitely not something that I want to hide from. I want to run to it, the opportunity to draw those hands and fingers. Shaded, and he's got a lot of fur on his leg. Now at this point I'm getting into that phase where just I'm gonna go around and see what looks finished enough and see where it needs more attention. And here there is a situation where the light single hairs are gonna kind of help. leg there, kind of defined by some of the fur. At this point in the drawing, if you've been kind of going along with me, you'll notice that the pencil is quite a bit sharper in one place or another. And so, you can rotate the pencil to kind of use that to your benefit. Like, if I want this area to look a certain sharpness or a certain flat softness, I can kind of, find that spot on the pencil. Like, this would be really sharp right here. And, so those sharper lines are nice for, obviously, for delineating where you want the edges to just be more pronounced and clear. And you could rotate around and find a spot where it's much softer. That's a pretty sharp one. And softer, and use it so, like, you can, rather than, busting out a different pencil every time, use the full benefits of working your drawing for a while, because it is nice to have the different flatnesses and sharpnesses on the same tool, especially if you know where they are and you're kind of being mindful of it. You can definitely employ the sharpening aspect of prolonged drawing sessions to your advantage. So this is very similar drawing other animals or drawing, anything else we've done on my channel so far. This, like, even a cube or something. It's just a matter of blocking it out and paying attention to the lights and the darks. And some of my videos about simpler objects are really, fundamental to understanding how to do something that, on the surface may seem more complex because it's a chimpanzee and there's just a lot more going on. And it is, in a lot of ways, like, biologically, of course, it's much more complex than a cup. But there's a sort of, like, a Master Yoda kind of thing about it too. Like, there's no difference, it's just different in your mind, kind of. And so understanding that, you can draw whatever you want if you just learn the basic process and then study the angles and the lighting. And it's not, there's not really, like, a hard and fast formula how to draw from life, but there is this, like, sort of way to a way of, seeing that can translate into two dimensions that's much more accurate to reality. And that's realism, I think, is that's why just I love it so much, is that it gives you something to shoot for and help plus reality is just so wonderful. I mean, it's worth looking at all day. You know what? I mean, really just identifying these dark spots and these light spots. And these, you know, working on life drawing, like, it can just improve all the other aspects of your, like, if you paint or if you sculpt. I mean, if you do any of that stuff, you probably know all this already. You know, just seeing how other people draw, and all this stuff is really good for helping you build your own skills as a you know, artist in a realist framework. It's kind of got these like spider webby things going on there too. And let's get a little more shading there and a little bit of, forgot these nostril ridges. Kind of crinkles and a little bit of shadowing. Under his lip, there's this nice, soft, rather thin shadow that kind of just makes this very ever so slight triangle toward the center. Kind of bracket shaped or something. And then it's quite a bit lighter on that part of the chin. So let's see. I'm just going to take a quick look at my picture and see how it's reading, and step back and see what needs fixing and what needs to, what looks good, and getting pretty close to that point. Maybe a little bit more shading up by the ear here. I am using a 2B pencil again. The paper is, you could use printer paper. I'm using this sketching paper I got from, it's 50 pound paper. I wouldn't necessarily recommend it unless you're going to do a ton of drawings that you're not really, you're studying, you're not really concerned about, you know, I want to show this off to people. For studying, it's great. And, you know, I mean, but it's basically just a little grainy. Really, I think the paper on this one, it's not as important as just the going through the process of seeing and studying, and lots of places to give you, like here, got these like stubbles on his chin. You can represent that by kind of like using the sharp edge and getting in there from the other side, from the shadows. And here, maybe a little darker. Just finding, basically finding the places that do need to be darker. And there's this like kind of bright white spot here too. So yeah, I mean, it's kind of getting a little bit redundant, but the going and seeing where it needs to be darker and wash, rinse, repeat. A lot of times what will happen is as you're darkening the picture in certain areas, it'll make other areas look lighter than they did before. Like these white spots will look a lot lighter when they're next to just something really dark than they would when they were just kind of next to something light gray or whatever. Because the contrast is higher. And that intensive contrast and intensity makes it so that when you know you've shaded in one place and you've shaded in the whole thing and you look back and you think, oh, I need to shade more there. And those changing contrast values, contrasting values will kind of play a part in that. And so I usually make a little speech at the end of my videos about how I hope this was useful to you, and certainly this video is no exception. I hope this, if you're still with me, I hope this was useful and helpful and fun, and that you liked it, and you know that you look forward to coming back and drawing with me again. Could use a little bit more wrinkle here or something. And I'm definitely, like when I see stuff like that, I'm definitely not trying to make anything up. I'm just trying to look more closely at the photograph and see how it is there, and then translate that on over to my picture. And I find that that gives me more practice studying life, as well as I'm more pleased with my results when I don't try to imagine something in there. I just, because your imagination is going to get in there anyway. I'm not trying to suppress it or anything. It's just that like imagining things comes natural to people, and studying life is not as obvious, I guess. I just find that, you know, the closer I can, the truer I can be to the realness of it, then the realer, the more real it will look. And then I just am, I'm kind of blabbing on about nonsense at this point, but artistic nonsense nonetheless, I suppose. So here is a place where, rather than like a single hair, there are these like kind of W shapes and M shapes, and looks like a pretty dark line under his foot. A little bit of shadow. So that's about concludes this chimpanzee holding a small piece of paper or like packing paper or something. Rather than leave his footprint white, I'm gonna get in there and give it some tone and just leave it white on the top where it's close to paint. It's hitting the light. And let's quick get in here and amp up the shadow a little bit. And again, with his arm and these shadows on the paper, let's get in there and and so then it's just a matter of how much time you want to spend and put into adjusting it and getting the values that you want out of it. All right, so thanks for watching, and I hope you like and subscribe, and hope to see you again next time.